Okay, welcome back. Thank you for being here. I hope everyone is well. Today, as I just said, I want to take a lateral move, a move off to the side, at which position we will then go deep. As I've discovered over the last week, the readings that I've done from the website nonduality.com regarding Sky of the Heart, Jewels of Wisdom from Nityananda. Actually, those several sub chapters or chapters were of the introduction to the book. And I didn't even look because I'm just sort of sleepy. But it seems that most of the rest of the book, Jewels of Wisdom or Sky of the Heart, most of the rest of the book is Chittakash Gita, meaning Nityananda's utterances. From a 7-year, 4-year, 7-year period in the 1920s. And it's arranged in a unique way, different than standard arrangements that I've found of Chittakash Gita online. And so rather than read the physical book, Sky of the Heart, what I want to do is read Chittakash Gita. And absolutely, I am unqualified. But some may say I am. Or, there you go. And it's 286 utterances coming out of trance or from some expanded state of consciousness and awareness, not intended for publication, not intended to guide the student. Nityananda was just speaking from his awakening at devotees' houses in South India in the 1920s. And I don't presume to understand it fully. I presume that I can understand a little, and I think it's worthy of recitation, repeating, speaking to you. It's beautiful and deep and beyond my level and beyond your level, unless you are at his level. I'm drawing from a page or site called nityanandatradition.org, and there was something. This was prepared by, first of all, it's a standard numbering, different than the numbering of Chittakash Gita verses from Sky of the Heart book. So Sky of the Heart, compiled by Captain Hattengi and Chaitanyananda. I believe Chaitanyananda reordered the verses in a different way from the standard ordering of the 286 that I'm finding in a couple of places online. And he gave some commentary, and I will give some commentary, but not as much. Hopefully, I'll be well restrained. Because really, again, it's beyond me. And in a way, this is not, it's not up for debate. It's his awakening. He's speaking truths from his awakening. Now, some people will think he's a fraud, I guess. Some people could think that. Or he's not so great, or my guru is better. Fine. There's an interesting set of. I'm going to ease my way into this, where first I want to talk about the immaturity of us seekers. Then I want to give the introduction from nityanandatradition.org on Chittakash Gita. Then I will read some of the verses, starting from one, going from maybe 1 to 50 today, or 1 to 20. We'll see how long it goes. And there is a glossary link that I also provided. There's a better glossary actually in Sky of the Heart, but I don't see it online. The first is this matter of who's right and who's wrong, and us seekers or us who are not finished. Carla said bozos on the bus. I think that's pejorative. I won't say, you or I are bozos on the bus. But the reality is, there's a heck of a lot of disagreement within communities in each of the religions, particularly here in this case, Hinduism and Buddhism. And in the end, I think number one, people should simply go with what seems true and important and helpful to you. You can say follow your feeling, but sometimes teaching is upsetting or truth is bitter in the taste. The taste of certain truths are bitter to certain people sometimes. That's not rare. It's kind of common when we've been in wrong view. Getting out of wrong view generally requires some kind of shattering armor, disillusionment, cognitive dissonance, passing through phase, a phase of passing through cognitive dissonance, like we find our beloved teacher is a scoundrel. I didn't, I mean, my teacher, Eido Roshi, from Daibosatsu Zendo in the early 80s, I knew he was a scoundrel, but he was not bad to me. But disillusionment is common, and we're just doing our best, and some people cannot live together. Not every teacher is suitable for each student. Not every teaching is suitable for each student. What I say is true and helpful. You may say is wrong and deluded. I think what's really helpful is to not waste time criticizing each other. And yet, it's important to be honest if we think someone's a fraud or deluded or a scoundrel and a bad person. But once we know it, I think that's enough. Go away. If you don't like the teacher and the teaching, go away. And that's how it should be done. My stepsister was a student of Muktananda. Muktananda claims to be in the succession from Nityananda, but I don't really think so. All the students of Muktananda say he was. The students of the students of Nityananda will say Nityananda is directly from Nityananda. I don't think so. Actually, Nityananda, I don't think, had any disciples. He had only devotees. He didn't name a successor. And everybody's got their opinion. I don't think that Muktananda can hold a candle to Nityananda, nor to the others. So my stepsister left the Muktananda organization after he died. He was her guru. When he died, she couldn't generate bhakti guru love for the successors, who were a brother and sister, one of whom then got thrown out by a scandal, and the sister took over. And some people love her, and some people don't have any feeling for her, and some people don't like her, and some people think that she's the best. There you go. And so this website, nityanandatradition.org, was prepared by someone named Swami Shankarananda, about 80-year-old fellow, student of Muktananda, who is considered by these people in the direct lineage from Nityananda. Meanwhile, I don't think Nityananda thinks so, even though they love him. It doesn't matter, you love me. meaning, I believe his view is, you can love me, that's nice, but I didn't nominate you in my as my successor, and you're not in the direct. There's no direct lineage. He didn't establish a lineage, but they may consider themselves in a lineage. And in the end, it just doesn't matter who you don't like. Stay away from them, and find what you do like, and don't waste a lot of time disliking who you dislike. Dislike them and move along. And so, in this page, about this site. The title of the page is About This Site from Swami Shankarananda, student of Muktananda. I got a little epiphany. Down the page, there's a section called This Website and the Lineage, an Integral Point of View, he wrote. Several of the branches of our tradition, meaning his view that Muktananda's tradition comes out of Nityananda, as Muktananda and the followers of Muktananda believe, and those that are of his successor, this woman who was a sister of a brother, who were lineage holders until he got thrown out from some scandal, which happens commonly. He goes on, several of the branches of our tradition hold widely differing views that sometimes clash with each other. In this website, we've endeavored to take an integral perspective, one that can include everyone with their disparate viewpoints, while recognizing the common source from which their teachings and their Shakti flow. And he puts Nityananda at the center, saying that everything flows from him. I don't think that he established lineage. They established lineage and claim that he's the source. I think he is an inspirational source to lineages that they feel come directly from him. I don't think he sees it that way. And other people will think that, who the hell am I to say that? You know, nobody's opinion has any more existential weight than anyone else's, actually. Even, you know, somebody says that Nityananda, I mean, I don't know what he said about himself. I mean, he's not saying, I am the God, I am the One, with capital letters. And some people would feel that he's an avatara. I mean, it seems to me he's of the level of Gautama, an eighth density being. Somebody else will say, I'm wrong. He may have said that. He really never said anything directly like that. In the end, my opinion has no more weight than Swami Shankarananda's or Muktananda's, actually. Some people will think what I'm saying, integrating the raw material and early Pali Buddhism and some of this Nityananda teaching of which could be called Advaita Vedanta or classic Vedantic yoga. Some people think this is great, and most of the rest of the world couldn't care less. What's true? I don't know. People essentially, what seems most important to me is to continue development and not get stuck with teachings and teachers that don't resonate. And a teaching and a teacher that resonates and from which you feel great development or love or value has no weight for anyone else. We may think, I may think, Nityananda and Gautama and Pali Buddhism and the raw material is a perfect union, and I love them all. And it means nothing to someone else or most other people. Am I right? Am I wrong? It just doesn't apply. It's irrelevant. It's not the point. The point seems to be take what works for you and drop what doesn't, and let everyone have their opinions. And if they don't like you, so be it. And if you don't like them, so be it. And if you think they're a fraud, so be it. And if you think they're great, so be it. So they think that they're coming out of a lineage from Nityananda. It looks to me like Nityananda established no lineage. And this point that views sometimes clash with each other. So you've got basically gurus, meaning teachers that are considered a guru to thousands of students who have sometimes radically different oppositional positions, oppositional views. Down the page, he said they arrange a list of 100 teachers. He said some are gurus, some are swamis, some are transformational teachers, and corporate teachers. Corporate teachers. And he's categorizing them one way or another. The category is not meant to be taken dogmatically. Considers, I guess he considers that all of them have been achieved, or they're all comparably achieved. I don't know. He goes on and says, it can't be denied that there have been political difficulties, misunderstandings, and differences in our tradition over the years. Unfortunately, this is also true in many other spiritual lineages. Yeah. So political difficulties, misunderstandings, differences, clashes, splits in the Sangha. It happens all the time. And yes, it's been true in other lineages as well. Take what works, what feels right, but look deeply, and don't be dogmatic. Because what feels right and is right for you now, you may later see as immature and poorly formulated later. And the teacher that I thought was great when I was young, maybe today I see has got a lot of distortion. Now, this may be simple, but for me, it's sort of the radical indeterminateness, the essential relativity of teaching and truth. It's relatively valuable to each who encounters it. And over time, the relative value may shift. And my interpretation is not sanctioned by anyone. And the one wearing a robe is sanctioned by his predecessor wearing a robe. That doesn't mean that that opinion is any better than yours or mine or the guy on the street. And so, sanction by institution, by lineage succession, doesn't mean that much because it depends. Eido Roshi, who was basically accused of raping many women, and he did. I have a close friend whose wife was accosted by him. It was traumatic for both of them. Yeah. Was thrown out by his board of directors at the Zen Study Society in recent, in the last 20, 30 years. I don't follow all the politicals. He was sanctioned in meaning given the imprimatur of authority to teach from his teacher, from his Roshi above him. I forgot the name. Cohen, maybe, Soen Roshi, whose teacher was a great guy. Soen Roshi's teacher. But the Soen Roshi had problem, and it went to Eido Roshi, and he became a rapist and traumatized a lot of people. Meanwhile, he didn't make trouble for me. Meanwhile, I left them because I didn't like the whole situation and I wanted something earlier, more original, so I went to Thailand. That was in the very early 80s. So, let the buyer beware. And all these guys in robes may disagree radically with each other. They plot sometimes. I mean, there are groups that have been accused of criminality in robes. There have been robe group, Buddhist and Hindu groups that have done murder for hire of each other. It's been established. I mean, there are cases on this in India, Tibet, and Japan. So we are down here on the ground in this 3D group. And it's good to know who you trust. It's good to know that the fact that they have authority conferred by a lineage is okay, but it doesn't really mean that much because there are psychotics in the Sangha and in the ashram sometimes. And some of them achieve, or some of them, I mean, a true teacher will see that, and that person will not be given authority to teach, but they may go out on their own and be a teacher. So my opinion is no more valuable than yours, and your opinion is no less valuable than a Roshi or a guru. And yet we should be clear when they know more than us, which may be common or mainly that they know many more things than we know. In other cases, they're completely wrong, or there is no right and wrong. But, well, there is. There is objective truth, actually. And yet, Ra said, understanding is not of your density. So, there's just some food for thought here and some ideas for you to consider. And I think it's important to look into that. So, let me go on. The second link I sent, also from nityanandatradition.org, intro to Chittakosh Gita. And this is from Swami Shankarananda. He wrote, "By every testimony, Bhagwan Nityananda was more a presence than a spiritual teacher. Seekers who entered his orbit would find themselves awakened, uplifted, and transformed as the flow of his spiritual power impacted them. But not everybody. Some remained seeking numbers for betting in the lottery. Certainly, he was not the type of guru who gave a coherent teaching, commenting on sacred texts, and placing himself in relationship to existing schools of thought and yoga. He had no interest in any of that. And that's why I say that he didn't establish a lineage. But these people feel that they're in his lineage. Okay. But he was not giving a guided teaching as Gautama did, as Ra did in their own way, answering questions only. Different than the Seth material, where he's just laying it all out and going on and on and on and on. So he wasn't commenting on sacred texts like I do. He didn't place himself in relationship to existing schools of thought and yoga in terms of his lineage, but they do, but I don't. And that's just, truth should be known and then integrated, distill the love light and move on. It goes on, "Hence, were it not for Chittakosh Gita, we would have only a few stray remarks from Bhagawan's mouth. Bhagawan said, do this. Bhagawan said, eat that. Bhagawan said, go there," and so on. Though even today we experience great Shakti, he feels that, by thinking about Bhagwan or contemplating his photograph or Murti, we have to count ourselves extremely fortunate that one set of his teachings, Chittakosh Gita, exists. Let me just see something if I can. I don't know everything, and so I don't even know what Murti means. Murti. But everybody's got their opinion. And there is no universally agreed upon basis for anyone's opinion being any more valuable than anyone else's. Even those that have 10,000 followers and are lineal successors in a 1,000-year-old lineage. It just doesn't mean that much in this world where you have filled with dishonest 3D repeaters, actually. And they may not be bad people, but they're not fully honest and committed to truth. So yes, one of his teachings, his speaking. You see, Nityananda's really in a different category. He's not even a teacher. He was a low I see him as a logoic force here to assist planetary evolution in the 20th century. He was a logoic incarnation or a member of the Guardians here to facilitate to keep some ballast for planet Earth during the 20th century. He goes on, according to Captain Hattengi's account from the Nietzsche Sutras, which is a very fine book and very hard to find from Rudra Press. That's another rendering of Chittakosh Gita, actually. According to Captain Hattengi's account from the Nietzsche Sutras, during his early years in Mangalore, circa 1922, 1924, almost 100 years ago, Nityananda would start a monologue while visiting various devotees' houses. At first, the devotees thought he was speaking nonsense, but later discovered that his words contained an odd but exalted wisdom. He seemed to be speaking from a state of higher consciousness or a trance, and a few decided to make notes about what he was saying. So he's just speaking from his so-called state of expanded awareness. He's just speaking. His is in his awakened vision. Before making one of these utterances, Bhagavan would say, "Arjuna Mama," meaning Uncle Arjuna, "come and listen. Krishna Ajja, Grandfather Krishna, is going to speak." Maybe he's talking to entities in a higher density. Maybe Krishna and Arjuna were there for him. I don't even know if those are real beings, other than in the Bhagavad Gita. These are things I don't know. Somebody else will say they know. That doesn't mean they know either. Just because somebody says they know doesn't mean they know. They think they know. They may. And just because you think they do or they don't doesn't mean they do or they don't. And I don't mean to be pedantic about that, but there's some very, we not only have a world that's not committed to truth at all. Humanity is very little love of truth. Please. But we're under the veil in 3D, and understanding is not even of this density, just as Ross said. I think it's absolutely true. And somebody else will say, "No, I can know something perfectly." Okay, there you go. That's a strange situation to be in, you know. So, he goes on, these words were an announcement that another extraordinary transmission was imminent. After some time, Tulsi Amma, a female devotee, collected and organized the scraps of paper the listeners produced. She went to Bhagavan Nityananda to talk to him about publishing them. He told her that his remarks came from the Chittakash, or space of supreme consciousness, and he didn't care whether they were published or not, of course. Despite Bhagavan's indifference, Tulsi Amma got them published in Kannada, the language, or a language in southern India, as Chittakash Gita. The first English version was produced in 1940. That would be very interesting if somebody could track that down. These utterances are striking in their uniqueness. The voice and vision of Bhagwan Nityananda is unmistakable. He cannot be put into a single box, indeed. He's neither simply a Vedantin, a yogi, or a devotee. His teachings contain elements of all of these, meaning representation of the Vedic tradition, ancient texts, or the yogic tradition of energy, consciousness development by technique and practice, or devotee, bhakti path, lover of some deity or guru. His teachings contain elements of all of these. He talks about pranayama, the upward movement of prana, the omkar, the mind-free state of a great being, mind-free, the need for a guru, the practice of sadhana, or practice, especially bringing the mind to perfect silence, critical, and the primacy of direct spiritual experience over mere theory. All this is delivered in a terse, elliptical manner, which can be obscure, meaning hard to understand, for sure, but always stimulates the intuition for those who care and is filled with energy for those who can feel it, according to him, and I'd agree. But that doesn't hold any truth or any weight. It's truth, whatever truth, who can say, right? That's what we've got. At best, as Ross said, we have truth without proof. And authority confers no legitimacy, actually, because there are bad people in lineages, in human religious lineages. Not all, very few, but some. And there are levels of awakening, and not everybody even seems to know that, even though they may be a lineal successor in a 2,000-year-old lineage or four. That's the case. And so you can love who you love and hate who you hate, but it has no bearing on me, actually. Just like my way has no bearing on you. Doesn't matter what I think for you. You got to go for where you find truth and meaning and value by application. The application of a teaching determines its value. If upon application you find it's useful and helps you, then it is. And if not, then not. And so, at the same time, he goes on, at the same time, the aphorisms are full of homey images of village life. Bhagwan is particularly fond of using images from cooking to demonstrate yogic points. That's like alchemy. Even more than that, he loves images from travel, boats, planes, cars, and especially trains, so that it seems the spiritual journey is a journey indeed, which it is indeed, although it's all an illusion, and there's no time and space, actually, and the whole thing is a big dream. The Chittakosh Gita, then, is neither a novel, nor a poem, nor a philosophical text, nor an essay. It's pure meditation in verbal form. Yeah, it's a verbalization of Nityananda's awakening. And that's why it's beyond all of us, including him, to fully comprehend. And even Nityananda didn't spend time explaining it at all. He goes on, concludes, it should be read slowly and used as a springboard to enter that same space of consciousness from which it is generated, the Chittakosh. And Chittakosh, Chitta, see, even though they spell it C-H-I-D-A or C-H-I-D, it's the same as C-I-T-T-A. It's one level of mind, or it's one way of defining mind. On the page from nonduality.com, which has the same 286 verses in the same ordering as nityananda.org.site, there is also a definition of citta. And it is important to know that there's citta, and there's manas, and there's buddhi, and then there's ahamkara. And the false self, and then there's a true self. There's jiva, and there's jivatman, and there's paramatman. And so there are a lot of terms that I'm not a scholar of. I'm not a Buddhist and a Hindu scholar. Chitta in nonduality.com is defined as mind stuff. But chit is considered the principle of universal intelligence or consciousness. Those are very different. We're talking about universal intelligence or consciousness. That sounds like buddhi and discernment. And what is a principle of universal intelligence anyway? It's, I would say, sentience. But chit is not the same. See, there's manas, and there's buddhi, and there's chitta. And so, to say that chit is the principle of universal intelligence or consciousness, which I could call the sentience of light itself, or the mind principle. What is the mind principle? What is mind? Right? What is mind? Well, there's illusory mind, and there's true mind. Buddhist teaching can include no mind. Well, Nityananda talks a lot about transcending mind, but it doesn't mean transcending the principle of universal intelligence. And so defining citta as mind stuff seems like contents of mind, but no, because then it's defined, chit is a principle of universal intelligence, and then chit akash, in their definition here on non-duality, is consciousness in its aspect as limited and unbounded knowledge and intelligence. So if we say that chit is sentience itself. What is sentience? The function of the luminosity of light and vibration. The luminosity of vibration. Intelligent energies, self-reflectivity. The self-reflectivity, the very vibratory nature of intelligent energy in the raw system, the raw material system, right? Prana. Is prana different than chit? Right? Intelligent energy in the raw material looks like prana to me. Prana, in one place here, is defined as life force or vital air. Okay? Vital air which pervades the body. Vital and physical breath. Prana. Is that different from Chip? Perhaps not. In Sky of the Heart itself, there's a very fine glossary, in fact, much bigger than the one on nonduality.com. Here, Chit, it's very funny. Chit is defined as absolute consciousness, but Chitta is defined as individual consciousness. And so there, they define Chitta as the mind of the empirical individual composed of the three elements, buddhi, ahamkara, and manas. This is what we looked into before last week, that threefold division. And I think that that's actually very well done. And so, nonduality.com had, it's very funny, they don't, the glossary on, their glossary online is nowhere near as comprehensive as the glossary in Sky of the Heart. And so, in keeping with what I read last week, seeing that they say there are three aspects of mind, buddhi, called ascertaining intelligence or discriminative understanding, ahamkar, meaning I consciousness, so-called ego, and manas, perceiving intelligence. He writes in Sky of the Heart, in the sutras, as in general English usage, mind is often used as a synonym for both citta as well as the more limited manas. So they define manas as more of this, very similar perhaps to samskara, the fabrication, the fourth skanda in the five aggregates, being compounding, fabrication, fashioning, mental fashioning, both the function of mental fashioning of thought form, as well as the product of such fashioning, which is thought form, which is composite. That samskara seems to be close to their usage of the word manas, which is just the lower function of mind. It's not the higher. So in Buddhism, then you've got the fifth skanda called vijnana, which is consciousness. That may be akin to buddhi, actually. But Gautama said that even consciousness is born of ignorance. And so the one who's free, who's in complete freedom or complete and perfect enlightenment, or nirvana, nibbana, is not, in Buddhism, would not be considered living in some kind of supreme eternal consciousness. Absolutely not. Yet, there is this term, Vijñanam Anidasanam, in Pali Buddhism, which we just talked about, and I'll look into it next week. We're trying to rectify Vedantic conception of mind, of the mental principle, pre and post awakening. Pre-awakening, this Vedantic system seems to divide it into manas, buddhi, and ahamkara. Where chit comes into that, I'm not quite sure. Buddhism, you've got fourth and fifth skandhas, samkara, samskara, and vijnana, or consciousness. Both of those are subject to the three marks in Buddhism, meaning they're impermanent, arise, persist, passed away, insubstantial, anatta, they're really empty of any abiding reality, and dukkha, or stressful. Fine. Meanwhile, there is this term, vijnanam anidasanam, meaning consciousness without surface. Now that looks a little bit like chit, or chittakash, or intelligent infinity, or unbound awareness. But a Buddhist won't say that. But they did have a lot of trouble with it. And you know what? Any person's opinion is no more or less valuable than mine or yours. One guy says it's this, another guy says it's that. One guy who's a lineal successor meaning he's in the lineage and he's a successor, he's a holder. His opinion is not necessarily any more or less valuable than yours or mine, actually, because they have disagreements among themselves. They have disagreements among each other. They do. They do. That's why they're called many schools. That's why Theravada split into multiple schools. Then we split to Mahayana. They have multiple schools. Then they split to Vajrayana or Tibetan. They have four major schools. Each one of those schools has multiple sects. And they're disagreeing with each other too. How about that? So this is really the Tower of Babel, the planet of confusion, the law of free will or law of confusion working overtime. But we can simply say that there is there is the apparent reality of an experienced separative or apparently separate by experience, experienced as separate mind, selfhood. And in many ways, self is mind defined, meaning, like we just looked into the Sundarika Bharadvaja Sutta, where Gautama at one point says, what? He said, I am, I forgot the phrase. Anyway, the word atta means self or mind. And he's sort of saying, I'm mind awakened, but it also means self awakened or something like that. And so we define ourselves as we think. And freedom from lower mind, freedom from the illusory functions of mind, which are basically the compositing of fourth skanda, the thought form generation and thought forms, as well as the basic awareness of vijnana, which is not chittakash, actually. That's the point, is fifth skanda consciousness is not chittakash. It may be buddhi, but it's certainly not liberated, unbound awareness intelligence. Because the goal, as Ross said, akin to the logos, is intelligent infinity. So this is a real specialist talk, but it's useful if we're talking about, I mean, it seems to be irrelevant, but people talk about the goal all the time. Every single one of these traditions, none of which totally agree with each other, you know. There are dozens of Buddhist schools, there are dozens of Hindu schools, there are dozens of religious sects in the other religions as well. What does that mean? It means that you got to trust yourself to see which teaching works for you in the way of developing love, wisdom, balance, and ease, and ability to serve, and ability to be well, and balance and center, and settledness and stillness. So, with that kind of ragged introduction, I want to read a bit of Chittakash Gita. And I maybe just read some straight through because I'm tired of my own commentary. So, from the page nityanandatradition.org, Chittakash Gita verses 1 to 50. Let me see how many I can do without interrupting myself. And I just read them with the number, they're numbered 1 through 286. And some of them are very short, and some of them are very long, actually. I was so very surprised. Some of the latter verses or sutras are very long. So I'll just read them, read a bunch here, and you can reflect on it. I might read them twice over. Chittakash Gita, Nityananda, verses 1 to 50, starting. Verse 1. Yanis are mindless. To yanis, all are the same. They have no slumber, no dreams, nor sleep. They are always in sleep. The sun and the moon are the same to them. To them, it is always sunrise. The glass of a chimney lamp, when covered with carbon, is not transparent. Similarly, the carbon of the mind should be removed. 2. There are three nerves in the body: the sun, or the sushumna, the moon, or the ida, the star, or the pingala. The first is red in color, the second blue, and the third green. 3. Where these three nerves meet is the heart space, hridayakash. As we go on practicing yoga, the bindu sound is heard in the head. This sound is one, indivisible. 4. Just as camphor is consumed by the flames of fire, so also mind must be consumed by soul fire. 5. The copra, detached from the shell, it's a coconut, makes a dull sound when shaken. So also the soul and body must be thought of as separate. The first is light. By that light, all vices are consumed. 6. Just as we draw water from a well, we should draw breath. When we breathe out, it should be like letting down the bucket into the well. When we breathe out, it is the carbon, the impurities of the body. When we breathe in, it is the breath of omkar. Breath of omkar is the manas. 7. Manas is jiva, but their positions are different. Jivatman is Paramatman. 8. A man or woman should be educated. What is education? Jiva should know the secret that he is the Paramatman. So manas is jiva, but their positions are different, they're not the same. So manas as a term for lower mind, or very close to samskara. But their positions are different, meaning jiva is actually higher than manas. He says jivatman is paramatman, meaning atman is the logos. Sub logos, atman is sub logos, the sun, paramatman. Jiva should know the secret that he is paramatman. Who is speaking? Who speaks? What speaks? All is the one infinite creator, as Ra said. And so there is Paramatman, the greater Atman, beyond Atman, the essential Atman, which is the Logos, which is a sub-sub Logos. Logos as basically the principle of vibration, the source of light, the will that generates light as a light by vibration, by word. The Logos as the word is the means by which infinity generates light. By the word, infinity generates light. The word is vibration. The word is love, as the Beatles said. And so, infinity, by its will, wiggles, and that generates vibration called the word, the logos. That logos is love, light, love, and generates light, which is the basis of the seven rays or the octaves. So you've got manas, jiva, which is jiv-atman or atman. Then you've got logos or sub-logos, solar, which is Paramatman or Parabrahman. Parabrahman might be above Paramatman, I'm not sure. I'm not sure if he does. You know, Hinduism is very close to the raw material, actually, very close. The raw material, raw, you know, who was teaching those ancient yogis? Maybe they were Venusian teachers. So seven, Manas is Jiva, and higher self, definitely, you know, like form, maker, body, sixth chakra, sixth dimensional energy field, generates form, the form of body, mind, spirit. Likewise, manas generates thought form, just like samskara, I'd say. I'm learning along the way here. I've never really thought about the relationship between the Vedantic usage of the term manas and the Buddhist usage of the term samskara, sankara, fourth skanda. All right? I'm learning along the way. And my opinion is no more valuable or less than yours. And yours is no more or less than mine. Yeah? It's a funny thing, this world. And so, truth without proof. Proof. There's no proving anyway, anywhere, anyhow. We just believe what we believe. And either we're doing better or doing worse over time. So manas is jiva, but it's the lower function of mind. Jiva is above it, but it acts by manas or samskara, yeah. But that's not the same as consciousness. Maybe jiva is similar to consciousness and buddhi. Manas is sankara. But jivatman is paramatman, meaning the essential nature of jivatman. See, jiva as soul, manas as the, let's just say, compounding function of mind. Jiva soul is above that compounding function, but above that jiva is something called jivatman, which is really not the different than atman, yet its true nature is paramatman, meaning the logos. What is the education? Jiva should know that the secret that he is a paramatman. That's the point, is that mind, body, spirit complex, and higher self Atman, and seventh density totality complex, are just vehicles of logos. Who speaks? Who speaks? The one speaks. You and me, not Scott, arrogant, fool Scott. The one speaks always. The one is always speaking. The only one speaking is the one. The only one speaking is the one. Always, for all. The question is, how well has one purified manas, and, you know, free of lower triad blockage, so that one knows that one is the one that is the only one speaking everywhere? That's sameness of vision, I'd say. So, 8, jiva should know the secret that he is the paramatman. What's the difference between Atman and the Logos? 9. Paramatman is in Jivatman. The real mukti, liberation, is to know the subtle in the gross. So, manas is in jiva, but jiva is above manas, or soul, is above the compositing mind. But the nature of that jiva is jivatman. But the nature of that jivatman is paramatman. Paramatman is in jivatman, meaning God is, the kingdom of heaven is within. Ba-boom. That's it. The kingdom of heaven is within. You think that paramatman is different than the kingdom of heaven? We're not talking about fourth density kingdom of heaven. We're talking about God as the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is God's realm. God's realm is no separate from God, and God is the Logos. So God is within. Paramatman is in Jivatman, and Jivatman is the true nature of the one that experiences manas. The real mukti is to know the subtle in the gross. Okay. 10. We should leave off the gross sleep and sleep the subtle sleep. We should enjoy the sleep obtained from the practice of pranayama. Pranayama, like pranayama, is basically deliberate control and regulation of breath, which is a sort of a forcing method, I think, of clearing the lower triad, facilitating arousal of full kundalini root to crown, clearing the Sushumna by way of Ida Pingala from root to crown. It's not a Buddhist way, and I think a lot of people have gotten into a lot of trouble with it because they have lower triad blockage and they can't get rid of that while they're forcing energy from root to crown. In any case, one may sleep better when one does regular meditation, of course, whether or not it's pranayama, especially if it's not even just doing vipassana, one can sleep better. Let me go on. 11. The upgoing breath is like the wheels inside a clock. Its movement is inside. When the movement of the breath is internal, one will see the world in himself. 12. Just as we see the sky reflected in the water in an earthen pot, so also, to the internal vision, the sky of consciousness, Chittakash, becomes visible. So let me read that again. Just as we see the sky reflected in the water in an earthen pot, so also, to the internal vision, Chittakash becomes visible. 13. If food is prepared in a gold vessel, the dog eats it. If it is prepared in an earthen vessel, then also the dog eats it. Food is food. Bodies are great or terrible, doesn't matter. But nourishment is nourishment, or the essence of what one is. This is just one interpretation. There are many ways of interpreting. So there are many teachings that are good, and there are many teachings that are useless to any one person at any one time. There you go. The dog doesn't care about outer. Is that wisdom or crudity? But what's inner is more valuable than what's outer. It's more critical to the work, the inner, not the outer. And even with this whole notion of multiple schools with multiple opinions that sometimes clash and they split and schisms and sects and all that, that too is outer. What's inner is, like Ross said, that every tradition offers a clear path to the one for the sincere seeker. And so, I mean, a person whose heart is open may see truth all over the place. And a person whose heart is closed sees shit all over the place. Absolutely. There are people who walk around smelling shit everywhere because the shit's in their head and they're just smelling themselves. But they're looking outside and blaming this, that, and the other one. Other people have flowers in their mind, flowers in their heart. And many places where they look, they smell beautiful flower and aroma because they're smelling their own flower. And others don't know what that means. Okie dokie. 14. The sunlight is reflected in the salt water of the sea. It is also reflected in the clear water of a tank at the top of a hill. It's not enough if we see with the eye, but we should experience it. And so, reflection, the sun, like Paramatman or God or the Logos or One Infinite Creator, reflects in salt water, reflects in clear water, reflects at the top of the hill, reflects at the bottom of the hill. The means of reflection are variable, but the nature of reflection is one. And one should understand the sunlight regardless of its reflection, just like one can appreciate the food regardless of its vessel. And also, it's not enough to see the outer, but one must taste the nature of the outer, which is an inner experience. So there's a big discussion here about outer and inner, and the relative value assigned, where to find value, priorities, determination of value in association to the reality of outer inner. There's outer inner, there's me and you, there's past, present, future, all of these polarities and dualities. multiplicities. Regardless of multiplicity, duality, polarity, the variable forms, there's an inner. There's a more highly valuable than the changing outer forms, which may be the form of day and night, or the form of male and female, or the form of past and present future, or the form of high and low, or the form of countless sects that are all disagreeing with each other on various points. What's inner is that they can help us point ourselves towards universal truth. That's the point. And that's why Gautama says, don't get lost in the thicket of views. They've been arguing for thousands of years. Humans are arguing. They're a quarrelsome bunch, a bunch of squabblers. It's a planet of squabblers, the squabbling planet of 3D repeaters, the 3D squabblers. Fine. there's a thicket of views. Don't get caught with the thorns. 15. On a tree grow numberless flowers. The flowers all perish, but the tree does not perish for a long time. The visible is like flowers. The invisible is like the tree. The visible is the physical. The invisible is the metaphysical. The visible is the outer. The multiplicity, duality, polarity, change, temporality, linear sequence, sequentiality, the yin and the yang is a visible, is an outer, it perishes. The invisible is the metaphysical, the unifying principle, the unifying, the one which is the true nature of the many, that which never changes. It's the deathless. Essentially, Gautama said, the deathless. Find the deathless, and one can much more easily accept regular death. 16. There are matches in a matchbox. Fire is produced only when the match is rubbed against the side of the box. So, also, the manas, which we can call lower mental functioning, is the match. Intelligence, buddhi, is the side of the box. We should rub the manas against buddhi, and then we get the kingdom of self, atman, which is the same as the liberation from the cycle of birth and death. You know, atman is not the end of the line, but when he says... you see, this is the funny thing. There's some Hindus, it seems, and Vedantists, who equate Atman with liberation. And there are others who seem to equate Atman returning to Paramatman as liberation. I'd agree with the latter view. If you think that Atman is the end of evolution, you're wrong. If you, like Nityananda, if you understand that Atman returning to its true nature, being Paramatman, is the end of the line or mukti. Okay, I'm with you. And so I think that's very subtle. And so there'll be some places where you will see, where I saw just recently, I had a moment of horror. Oh my, it looks like he's saying that Atman is the end of the line. No, I can't be, because I know that's not the case. Just sixth density, no big deal, really. It's a busa, bodhisattva. But no, actually, what he really means, when they say self with a capital S, it seems to me to be akin to Jivatman returning to its true nature of Paramatman, which is sub-logos, Atman, sixth density, returning to sub-logos, solar, eighth density, right? Leaving the octave, which is the deathless, because it's beyond range, as Gautama would say, beyond range. Beyond the range of the five skandhas, beyond consciousness, absolutely, beyond the consciousness born of ignorance, but not beyond consciousness without surface, which akin to infinite awareness or non-compounded awareness, intelligent infinity, infinite intelligence, or this principle. And it's really above buddhi, too. It's actually above buddhi. And it's probably what Nichiranda means by sky of the heart, Chittakash. Chittakash as the sky of liberated awareness, intelligence, boundless intelligent awareness, awareness, intelligence, the mind of God. I mean, I'm not there, but that may be what they're saying, that the mind of when Jivatman or higher self has returned to the deathless and become one with Paramatman, there its mind has become Chittakash, and that's not in the seven chakras, actually. It's out of them, or the seven becomes the seven chakras becomes one. It all gets rolled up into seventh chakra, Brahmarandra, seventh chakra, in the end of the line, and then there's time. Okay. I will read. What should I do? Maybe that'll be it for today. Completing Sutra 16. So, we should rub manas against buddhi, and then we get the kingdom of self, which is the same as the liberation from the cycle of birth and death, or samsara. And so the kingdom of self is the deathless. I mean, again, some people will say yes, and some people will say no. Now what? And if you don't like this, why are you here, by the way? Or you like it and you don't like it. I would not recommend staying in a place which you don't like. But some people are masochists. Okie dokie. And others find value and go where there's value. And it's very personal. So the spiritual path is profoundly personal. And so we may be sitting in a group or listening to the same teaching in a group, but each one takes it in differently, and each one makes of it unique, a unique result. And there's no proven unified authority. This really is a realm of non-understanding. While we can get some understanding, there's no proof of anything in the way of true statements. And in a way, like Ross saying, understanding is none of your density. Disagreement comes with the territory in 3D, under the veil, and that's okay. And yet, one can be more and more free of confusion. And yet there's no proof that that means one's doing the right way. There are a lot of zealots who are free of confusion, too. There are a lot of murderers and crazy people. There are psychotics who will say, I have no confusion. I am Napoleon, and I know it. Something like that. So, welcome to the land of the unprovable. So, in any case, it's very strange, and I have no final conclusions on that matter, either. I can't even summarize it perfectly. Or excellently for my own liking, but in any case, I think this is wonderful, and I hope you enjoy it. I enjoy this. I hope you enjoy it. Please find what you enjoy, and go where you feel well, and leave where you don't feel well if you can, unless you enjoy feeling pain, which can be useful if you wish to work through it. So I think we'll end here with Sutra verse 16. Next time, pick up at 17 and just see how it goes each reading. Thank you to all involved, the website and Captain Hatengi and Chaitanyananda's glossary, and all those who say they're of a lineage. So, anyway, please take good care of yourself. That's most important. And I hope to see you next week. Okay, good night.